Bom dia, good morning. We are here with Professora Roberta Rabelotti, that is from University of Pavia, from the Department of Political Science. And it's a pleasure to have her among us. She comes for the SASE Congress, and we had the opportunity to discuss with her about her recent research that is about greening value chains. We could say like that. Professor Rabelotti holds a PhD from the IDS of University of Sussex, and she has been working with innovation issues with a lot of interest on developing and emerging economies. I personally knew your work because of the GVCs, Global Value Chains Research, that you work on with a lot of relationship on innovation issues. Then, well, I think that's all. It's a great pleasure to have her with us. She has been working with GlobalX, a group for a long time, and then I think we can have some interesting discussions here. Obrigada, e lhe deixo a palavra.
Okay, so muito obrigado. Thank you very much. It's really a great pleasure for me to be here. It's my first day in Rio, so just arrived yesterday. And I really would like to thank you very much, Marina Sapiro, for organizing this seminar. I know that it's not a good period. The university is just starting an holiday period, but it's a great pleasure for me really to be here and to have the opportunity to share with you some recent work I have done in collaboration with Rasmus Lema, with Dalida Ribaudo and Elisabetta Gentile. This is something, is a background, what I'm going to present is a background chapter we prepare for the next Asian Development Bank Global Value Chain report. So the topic and the very general question we are addressing in this chapter is how can global value chain contribute to greening the global economy, as I say in the title. And so I'm not spending time in defining what is a global value chains and the importance of global value chains in also in particular in latecomer countries, in getting latecomer countries involved in global trade. But as I said, the focus of what we have done is on understanding the environmental consequences of global value chains. And we can distinguish about three different effects that global value chains can have on the environment. The first effect can be defined as a scale effect. And this is due to the fact that given to global value chains, there was an increase globally of economic activities. And this increase in economic activities, of course, can lead to an increase in gas emission. Given the way in which value chains are organized, has also led to more transport volumes, more travels around the world. and also an increase in waste production. So, of course, and in some cases, in some industries, also to an over-exploitation of some critical scarce resources. So this is a scale effect. Then there is a composition effect, which is more related with the organization of global value chains. And this composition effect could be, in terms of the environment, both good or bad. It is good when, due to the way in which value chains are organized, some stages of the value chains are moved to countries where they are undertaken more efficiently. So this could be good from the environmental point of view, but it could also be bad because something which has happened in many value chains has been moving some stages from countries with more strict environmental regulation to countries where environmental regulation are weaker. So in this sense, this can be taken as a negative impact on the environment due to the increase of global value chains. And finally, there is what can be defined as a technique effect, and this is what this technique effect is specifically the focus of our work. And this technique effect is related with something which has been documented in the literature in global value chains in relation with the opportunity of value chain as a channel to access knowledge. So here the point is that through participation in global value chains, suppliers and local companies get the opportunity to access knowledge, which can become critical in terms of introducing environmental innovation in process, in product. And this aspect of this technique effect is what we are focusing in our work. So the focus of this background of this paper is really on this technique effect. So what we do in this paper specifically is to develop a conceptual framework to try to address a number of questions related with greening in GVC. And in particular, we are trying to understand why is GVC greening taking place, what does it mean, GVC greening, and so what? So what is the result, the outcomes of GVC greening? And the focus that we have taken in this specific paper is on traditional manufacturing and on latecomer countries. So what we have done is a survey of the empirical evidence available in the literature trying to address these three questions. And I'm going to present you this framework in a moment. In a different paper, which is related with this, because was also done on behalf of the Asian Development Bank, and again is in collaboration with Rasmus Lema and Elisabetta Gentile, we instead have focus on green global value chains. So we have focus on value chains of renewable energy industries. So understanding how, in particular, the wind, the solar, and the biomass global value chains are organized. But as this paper is available, so if you are interested, I can share with you this paper, but I will not have the time to present also this paper. So this is the conceptual framework that we have developed in our paper. As I was saying, we try to address three main questions. Why? is the first question. So we are going to investigate the drivers bringing greening, pushing value chains to become greener. We are focusing on what, so how the way in this this greening is taking place in global value chains. So basically the environmental innovations which can be introduced in value chains. And related with the what, we are addressing two complementary questions which are related to who, so who are the main actors involved in the in this value chain greening, and how, so the enabling mechanism which are important in terms of implementing this greening. And finally, the last question is, so what, so what is the impact of this greening? How we can measure this greening? Basically the outcomes of this greening process. So, I mean, this table is not very readable, but I have shared with you the paper, and I can share with you also the presentation. Basically, this table has been helping us in terms of disentangling these main questions in order to undertake our survey of the empirical evidence available in the literature. So basically what I'm going to present you is not new original evidence, it's based on empirical evidence available in the literature, which we have been searching and trying to find answer to these five different related questions. So the table can be useful because it's really trying to disentangle this question in sub-questions and trying to identify what can be found in the literature in order to answer to this question. So what I'm going to do in my presentation is to go column by column and to tell you what we have found in the literature about these five related questions. Of course, if you have questions, just stop me, and we can I can try to answer your doubt. So, first of all, the drivers of GVC greening. Talking about the drivers, we have identified three main different drivers: institutional drivers, market drivers, and technological drivers. So let me start from institutional drivers. Institutional drivers can be thought in terms of all the regulation which are introduced more and more by national government. So national government are introducing environmental legislation, and of course GVC need to satisfy these environmental regulations. So, for instance, one example is the carbon taxes, which has been introduced by Denmark, which is also going to be introduced by the European Union. And of course, global value chains will need to satisfy these rules. But what is maybe more interesting is that more and more regulations and environmental regulations are not only take into account the direct emission of companies, but they are also trying to measure the indirect emission of companies. So, for instance, the example of Apple is quite interesting. So, if you measure the direct emission of Apple, these are very limited. But if you go along the value chain, most of the emission due to Apple production can be considered as what are defined as scope-free emission. And scope 3 emission are defined as the emission which can be attributed to suppliers both downstream and upstream. So about 75% of Apple emission can be attributed to this scope 3 emission. And there are countries, and again Denmark is a good example, which are trying to measure this emission along the value chain, and so they are trying to make the leading companies in the value chain responsible not only for their direct emission but also for their indirect emission. So this is quite important. And finally, we can consider in these institutional drivers also some agreement which can also come from a private company. An example is Maersk, a logistic transportation company, which has introduced an agreement with all their with all its suppliers, trying to control the emission and the environmental standard not of all the supplier of this of all the supplier involved in its value chain. So it's a kind of private agreement, and which has been enforced by Maersk, and this can be also considered and in these among these institutional drivers. Then we have market drivers. So in this case, the driver comes from the requirement of the market, and the requirement of the market, the reason for these market changes can be attributed to different aspects of the market. First of all, there is a clear increasing preference of customers in existing market for goods which are, let's say, green good products. So customers mainly in rich countries, but also increasingly globally, they require that what they buy, or at least some niche of customers are requiring that the products that they buy are respecting some environmental standards. But then we can also consider a shift of market demand to green markets. So from location, customers which will prefer products coming from locations in which they know that environmental regulations are stricter, in which they know that environmental regulations are implemented in a kind of more stringent way. And finally, there could be also the possibility that some materials can be used. The demand can shift from market or from sectors in which environmental regulation are weaker to sectors in which environmental regulation are stricter. And an example is, for instance, the demand for lithium. Lithium traditionally has been used in ceramic and glass industry. Nowadays is used for production of electrical battery. And in this industry, there are stricter regulation in terms of environment. So the pushing of the market towards greening global value chain can come from different reasons that we can identify. Then the third, third drivers can be defined as technology drivers. So in this case, the idea is that technological change, changes, innovation can be supportive in terms of greening of a global value chain. And here, the focus in particular is on the introduction of the digital technologies in supporting the greening of global value chains. So here there is an increasing stream of literature talking about the twin transition, so how digital technology can support the green transition. So for example, how the artificial intelligence could improve energy use, how blockchains can facilitate trade within value chains, and so on and so forth. So this is an area of research which is booming in these days. I'm not going to get too much in detail on this, but if you are interested in this particular topic, with Rasmus again, we have been written another background chapter for the new UNCTAD Technology and Innovation Report, which came out just a few months ago, which is exactly on this on how digital technologies can support the greening of global value chain. So, if you are interested in this, I can share with you both the background chapter and also the report, which of course is available online, which is quite interesting because it's really a report that UNCTAD does every 2 years on the readiness of latecomer countries in the adoption of frontier technology. So maybe some of you could be interested in it. Sorry, I think I lost. Okay, so now let me come to the second question we have addressed. So, I mean, in this question, we are trying to understand the way in which greening is taking place. And here what we the focus is on environmental innovations. So the definition we give of environmental innovation is a radical or incremental change in process, product, or organizational model that result in the reduction of the chain ecological footprint. And the chain ecological footprint can be measured in terms of reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, improvement in terms of biodiversity, and improvement in terms of natural resource use. And what is important to emphasize is that GVC greening happens when there is a net environmental gain. So we will see how difficult it is to measure these environmental gains. But we will see that in some cases the introduction of environmental innovation can have positive but also negative impact. So there is a greening only when the difference between positive and negative is positive. So there is important to take into account that we need to consider the net environmental gains from the introduction of environmental innovation. So here I think I can go relatively quick because it's just for defining what is environmental process innovation, which can be the reorganization of the production process through the use of superior technologies, leading to increase in eco-efficiency, along with different stages of the value chain. So for instance, reduction or substitution of energy sources with renewable energies, reduction of waste, elimination of toxic input, optimization of material flow. So in our paper, we provide a number of examples from different countries in different industries of this kind of environmental process innovation. Then we have environmental product, environmental product innovation, and in this case it is introduction of environmentally friendly products, so for instance product designed for last longer, product using recycled input, product with reduced packaging or reusing waste. And we provide some example, and what is important to mention is that very often process and product innovation comes together. So it's very common that in order to produce more environmentally friendly products, you need to improve also your process. So the two, in theory, you can separate product from process innovation, but in the reality, very often you will find that the two takes place together. And finally, there are also some environmental organizational innovation. We have found example, for instance, of the adoption of lean manufacturing. So all those organizational innovation which are trying to minimize waste, to minimize to introduce recycling of some input and so on and so forth. So basically, the idea is that in order to undertake the greening of GVC, firms will introduce environmental innovations, and we can distinguish between these different types of innovation. Having said that, it is important to understand who within the value chain is undertaking this greening process, and so focusing on the actors involved in environmental innovation. And here we can distinguish between actors internal to the GVC and actors external to the GVC. When we focus on actors internal to the GVC, we can distinguish between the lead firms and the suppliers. Most of the of the literature about environmental innovation in value chain is focusing on the lead firms. So the idea is that the greening of the GVC is driven by the necessity of the lead firms to satisfy, for instance, the environmental requirements of the market in rich countries. And this, of course, there are a lot of examples, and here we can distinguish between, and this is something that comes from the literature on global value chain, between actors which are buyers, so value chains which are dominated by buyers, or actors, lead firms which are producer. So for instance, this is in the case of electronics or in the case of the car or the car industry. But what is quite interesting, and we have found several examples of this, is that in some cases suppliers can be the first one to introduce this environmental innovation. So there are cases in which suppliers are introducing environmental innovation not because they are forced by the lead firms, but because they identify this strategy as a strategy to be more competitive with respect to other suppliers. So somehow have found a number of examples in which this introduction of environmental innovation takes place at the level of suppliers and suppliers are proactive. So they are the first one introducing environmental innovation and to be strategically competitive with respect to our suppliers. Then we can consider our external actors to the GVC, and in this case the greening can be forced by policymakers, can be induced by customers in the market, and can be the NGOs can also, or the civil society organization can also play a role in terms of, for instance, enforcing environmental regulation which are driving this greening. But it's interesting to see that the policymaker have a role in this greening, which can also go beyond the introduction and enforcing of environmental regulation, because as I will explain in a moment, they play a very important role, for instance, in terms of building the infrastructure needed by global value chains to become greener. So, for instance, think about the infrastructure to recycle or reuse water, or the infrastructure needed for a company to shift from energy, from fossil fuel to energy, renewable energy. So these are infrastructure which will be need to be built by national or local government. Okay, so the other related question to the environmental innovation is how this environmental innovation is taking place, and so which are the enabling mechanism of this environmental innovation. Here we can first of all focus on environmental innovation enabled by lead firms. And here there are two models usually that can be identified and are documented in the literature. A model which can be defined as standard driven. So basically the lead firms, and an example is IKEA. IKEA has a protocol which is imposing to all its first and second tier suppliers. In fact, IKEA is enforcing to the first tier, but somehow the first tier suppliers agree to enforce the same kind of environmental standard to their second tier suppliers. And basically IKEA is fixing some environmental standard, and if you are a supplier of IKEA, you need to satisfy this supplier, and you need also to agree that your second tire supplier will also satisfy this environmental standard. So basically is a protocol, and then what does it mean? It means that the supplier will need to adapt, will need to get the knowledge in order, independently, in order to satisfy this standard. So there is no support usually on IKEA is not offering any support to the suppliers. Then there is another way of another pattern which can be found in the literature, which can define as mentor-driven approach. And here we have an example of an Italian company. It's a small, relatively small producer of kitchens. And what they do is they have a limited network of suppliers, and they work in collaboration with suppliers in order to guarantee that their suppliers satisfy their environmental standards. So they have introduced a line of product which are so-called green kitchen, so with less environmental impact, and they work jointly with their suppliers. So they don't just impose standard, but they collaborate with the suppliers and they pass on knowledge. So there is really a collaboration in terms of reaching the standard required. Of course, they are I don't have the time to enter into the details, but of course you can imagine that these companies, IKEA, Valcucina, are very different companies. On one side you have a big multinational which is really using kind of standardized codified knowledge, so just imposing standard. On the other side you have a relatively small company which is also and which are standardless, and the standards are less codified, so the result is that they really need more kind of communication and face-to-face knowledge exchange. Then there is the environmental innovation enabled by suppliers, and this, as I was saying, is quite interesting. There are some examples. We have found a very interesting example again from Italy in a lever cluster, but also from Pakistan. In which, as I was saying, the initiative of introducing environmental innovation is not taken because it's enforced by lead suppliers, by lead companies, but because suppliers identify the green strategy as a way to reduce their cost, as a way to be able to sell their product or services to the lead firms at a premium price. Basically, the initiative of introducing environmental innovation comes at the level of suppliers. Then we have found example of what we can call name as a collectively enable environmental innovation. The example are mainly from clusters. And in this case, the introduction of environmental innovation is the result of some collaboration between companies located in the same clusters. And this is very typical of clusters. Companies in clusters have experience of collaborating for introducing innovation, and in this case they are collaborating for introducing environmental innovations. It's more a result of a collective experience rather than a single experience, an experience at a single firm. And then we have the example of environmental innovation which are enabled by the state. We have this labor cluster in Italy is an interesting example because in this case the environmental innovation have been supported by the building up of the infrastructure needed, for instance, for the recycling of water. So some local infrastructure built by the state, by the local government, have been fundamental in terms of improving the environmental impact of the products in this cluster. But there is also another interesting example from Ethiopia, for instance. In Ethiopia, the state has built a network of industrial park with some which are called eco-industrial park, and in this industrial park they have the state has provided the infrastructure for using renewable energy industry, the infrastructure for waste treatment. So basically one of the strategic element for attracting international lead firms to this eco-industrial park has been, okay, if you, and in particular in the apparel industry, if you are coming to Ethiopia in this industrial park, we will supply you the possibility to access, to use renewable energy. And so it means that then the lead firms can satisfy some environmental, international environmental standards. So the deal between the Ethiopian government and the international suppliers has been also based on providing this basic basic infrastructure to satisfy international environmental standards. So let me come to the last last question, which is related with the outcomes of GVC greening. I should say that on this, the literature is much more confused in the sense that the first consideration that we can make is that to measure the real biophysical outcomes of the introduction of this environmental innovation is very complex. And it's very complex, and also the measure that you can adopt can be very different. So we have tried to find in the literature different measures used in order to quantify the environmental impact of this greening, and so you have measures such as, for instance, the reduction of CO2 emissions, or the reduction in terms of biodiversity loss, for instance, in the furniture industry, the increase in terms of sustainability in the land use, shift from using fossil fuels to renewable energy, the reduction in terms of use of toxic materials. So the indicators are very different, and in some cases several of these indicators will be needed in really in order to measure the biophysical impact of this greening. So there are many challenges from this point of view. The first challenge, as I was saying, is that the systematic measurement efforts are scarce. At least the literature is not very rich in this sense, and the outcomes are often very complex to measure. It's of course very difficult to isolate and to attribute casual factors. So it's very difficult to really measure that the introduction of a specific environmental innovation has had such an outcome, no? Because, of course, the causal effect relationship is very difficult to measure. And this is very common, given that in the GVC literature, very often the focus is on lead companies. Lead companies tend to emphasize, to stress a lot, the positive impact on the environment. I mean, we know all the literature about greenwashing. So very often they stress the positive impact that they have had in terms of selling more environmental friendly products, but then we don't know exactly what there is behind this final result. So it's really an aspect of the literature on which is still very, very weak and on which more empirical evidence is clearly needed. And then there is also a problem of trade-offs, in the sense that there are many trade-offs. So, first of all, for instance, the trade-off between, as I was saying at the beginning, between different possible environmental outcomes. So, for instance, if you think about a company moves from fossil fuel energy to wind energy, or in general to renewable energy, but of course renewable energy is also producing a lot of pollution. So we know that wind, for instance, the wind industry is a very polluting industry. And so if we only measure the positive environmental impact of this shift from fossil to renewable, we will conclude that there was a positive impact on the environment, but in fact, we are forgetting the fact that the production of wind energy is polluting, and so this is something that is usually not taken into account. Then there is, and this is also another important issue, the trade-off between environmental and socio-economic outcomes. Again, here is another stream of literature pointing out who is really gaining the benefit of the introduction of this environmental innovation. So are the benefit only gained at the level of the lead firms, or there is somehow a redistribution of this gain at the level of the suppliers? So there is literature showing that, in fact, very often, for instance, there are some papers by Stefano Ponte, in particular on the wine industry, showing how all the investment in terms of the introduction of this environmental innovation has been borne by suppliers, and all the gain has been gained by the lead companies or by the UK supermarket. So, all these social issues and distributional issues are, of course, key to take into account. And finally, again, there is here a very interesting paper by Stefano Ponte and some co-authors. They have undertaken a very detailed empirical case in Kenya. about a cluster producing horticulture vegetables for UK supermarket, in which they show that in order to produce these organic vegetables for the UK supermarket, in fact, there was a land degradation in Kenya because they had the local farmer had to shift from a model which was more based on rotation of different culture to a single culture, and the result was less use of toxic input but degradation of land. So if you do really, you try to calculate the net environmental impact, the net environmental impact on the local land was negative, although the UK supermarket could say that they are selling organic vegetables from Kenya. So, but of course, to show this is very complicated. What they did was a very detailed macro case on this Kenya producer. So it's difficult to generalize from this case. But this is something that we need to take into account. So this is all. I don't know if I have. I have a few slides on. Policy, if you want me to show them or you want just to stop here. Okay. I will try to keep it short. So, yes, the conclusion that we have tried to, given that also the focus of this paper, which, as I said, was for the Asian Development Bank, we have tried to draw some policy conclusion based on this framework I have presented, and so we have developed a strategy based on three different areas of policy intervention. First of all, first area, which will be, of course, how to create and augment the driving factors we have been identified. And here you can think about policy intervention both at the national and local level, but also at the global level. Of course, at national and global level, we have been talking about regulation and standards. We have been talking about, a possible policy is introducing a tax, but also it's important to remember that some global agreement can be also important in order to enforce this greening. For instance, agreement to avoid environmental dumping, to control transboundary toxic movement. These are, I would say, quite obvious areas of policy intervention. We can think about how it's possible to leverage the enabling mechanism to support the environmental innovation at different level. So here we can think about policies targeting lead firms and suppliers, policy which can be enforced at level of clusters, or policies aim at building and strengthening infrastructure. And something that, for instance, can be elaborated policy level could be strategies for green procurement at the level of the public administrations, the building up of green suppliers database. So in our paper, we have tried to find example of this worldwide example of these measures in clusters. We can think about, for instance, policies to support and to strengthen the green business, the green agenda of business association that we know can have an important impact on improving, on also directing the activity in terms of green innovation in clusters. And then, as I was saying, is important also the role that national and local government can play in terms of building up the basic infrastructure which are needed in terms of, for instance, shifting from energy from fossil fuel energy to renewable energy, or investment in recycling industries, investment in creating systems for collecting waste, and so on and so forth. Okay, and finally, as I was saying, another area which is really requiring a lot of attention is the monitoring of outcomes, also the need to address environmental inequalities. So it is important to enforce measurement, to really measure the environmental impact of this greening process, and it's also important to address the social unequal impact of greening within the chains, and to find, and this is something which will need more research, both at policy level but also in general, to find new way to share benefit in the different level of the value chain. So the lead firms, the suppliers, and also the in particular in some industry like in the mining industry or in agriculture, also a way to share the cost but also the benefit of introducing this environmental innovation at the level of a social community which are involved in this process. So this is something that will require more thinking in terms of addressing this the social impact of this greening process. So I think I can just stop here, and thank you very much, and I will be happy to answer or address your questions and comments. Thank you.